Hello, I present today a new episode of my program Eurointegrators, and my guest today is Ambassador of Lithuania in Ukraine, Marius Janukonis. Hello.
Hello.
How much does your country feel propaganda and other form of interference from Russia?
Our countries are living in a hybrid world. I mean, we face the hybrid aggression. So, of course, the Russian propaganda is a strong tool that Russia uses with the direction and with the consent of the state, of the government, and Lithuania, as Ukraine, is also affected by Russian propaganda. I think there are other methods that Russia uses against us and the whole Western civilization, the whole Western countries, such as cyber attacks and other tools.
Didn't check, unfortunately, for Lithuania, but for Latvia, I saw that approximately 50% of their TV share are Russian TV channels. What about Lithuania?
Of course, there are some Lithuanians who are watching Russian TV programs or reading Russian information in Russian. There were several examples which proved that our society is quite resilient to this propaganda. We remember, I can bring you one example when the NATO decided to reinforce its contingent in Lithuania, and there were new battalion from deployed in Lithuania from the NATO countries, particularly led by Germany. There was an attempt to just throw information that a German soldier raped a Lithuanian girl, but nobody believed that, and our society understood from the beginning that it was a fake news, and that was a good proof that we are able to withstand that.
Will relations with Ukraine and with Russia changed after elections in Lithuania?
We don't expect major changes in our foreign policy. I think the overall consensus between the political parties and politicians always has been a strong side of Lithuanian policy. Of course, our politicians can disagree on many things in domestic policy, but foreign policy priorities stable during the history, and from the early 90s, our political parties they even sign agreements on foreign policy priorities, and that helped us also for integration into European Union and NATO. So I don't see any indications that our foreign policy goals can change after the presidential elections. Ukraine is one of the priorities of our foreign policy, and I think it will continue.
Before you, Ambassador of Latvia was in my program, and he told about their political election law. And the difference with Ukraine is that media plans of parties are in analog of Ukrainian anti-corruption bureau. And they are checking that parties will not overspend the budget for political advertising. So it, like, all parties are in more or less equal conditions. Another change, which I understand is difference, which I understand, is that they have like a ranking inside the party list. So if voters would not like some politicians, which is number one in a party, they will put him vote them down. Was it maybe last number, and he will not be in a parliament. What about Lithuanian methods of political advertising or political law?
We have very similar system, and all the political parties, they must declare all the expenses and income. And of course, our anti-corruption institutions are following that very, very closely. Like in Latvia, we have open party lists. We have a mixed system, like in Ukraine. So half of our parliament members are being elected by majoritarian system and another half by proportional system. It means by the party lists. And those party lists are open, and our voters, they have possibility to rate those politicians. And in the end, they can change their positions within the party lists.
Lithuania has gone. It's passed to European and NATO integration. Ukraine is only in the beginning of its path. What is your recipe?
I don't think that there are universal recipes for euro integration, but as I said before, the political will is very important. The political will and consensus of all major political forces. And that was the case in Lithuania. As you might know, in the early 90s, former communists returned to the power in Lithuania, but it did not prevent us to continue our foreign policy goals like EU and NATO integration. And that was exactly President Brazauskas, who was former communist, who signed the letter to the Secretary General of NATO asking for NATO membership. Our political elite, they were decided, determined from the very beginning that we should return to the European family and to become members of EU and NATO.
Ukrlis Pol Brigade. Does it mean that Lithuania will help to solve us some security problems in any case?
I have to say that the idea to create such a joint military unit between Lithuania, Poland and Ukraine was raised long before the conflict in Ukraine started in 2014. So the aim of creation of this brigade was to help Ukraine to approach to NATO standards, also to prepare Ukrainian forces for joint participation in the international peacekeeping operations. Mm-hmm. So that was not the case that this brigade could be a part of joint defense unit.
But in case of peacekeeping process in Donbas, it could be.
Theoretically, it could be discussed, but I think we have to come a long way to agree on the peacekeepers in Donbas, and then we can consider that. But the Ukrainians are also part of this brigade, so in this context, it might be difficult for Ukrainians to participate in the peacekeeping operation in Donbas. But what is important that this brigade is helping very much Ukraine to achieve NATO standards and to really achieve more interoperability with NATO forces.
We have one more guest who joins our program by phone. This is Igor Umaski, the former deputy minister of finance.
Це перший заступник міністра фінансів Ігор Уманський. Ігор, доброго дня, ти нас чуєш?
Dear
Mr. Umaski, my question for you is the following. Lithuania is a country which fought for so-called Marshall Plan for Ukraine. This country helps Ukraine to carry out reforms in different sectors. What are the results?
The name is the new European Plan for Ukraine, because we always thought that Europe and the EU has to have a clear plan for Ukraine. Because security and prosperity of Ukraine is a big European interest, and it's also an instrument to change Russia. And of course, we have to work with Ukraine, with the Ukrainian partners, and also with the international partners to find the best way how to boost Ukrainian economy and how to increase investment in Ukrainian economy.
What is the main thesis of this plan?
The idea behind this plan is to boost economic growth of Ukraine and to increase both domestic and foreign investment.
Through which instruments?
Through international instruments, through existing international instruments of international financial organizations, but also in trying to find new financial instruments and also encouraging Ukraine to do reforms, because we know that once the reforms are being made, so there will be more confidence in foreign investors, but also in domestic investors.
What is, on which level of development is now this plan?
We are actively discussing this plan with the Ukrainian institutions and the international partners. And what Ukraine needs is to improve absorption capacity for foreign assistance.
Igor, what could you say about Marshall Plan for Ukraine?
Безумовно, ініціатива Литви, так званим планом Маршала,
of course, the Lithuania's initiative to provide such a plan for Ukraine would help the country to become strong. It would help to create a kind of additional barrier between Russian threats and Europe. And Baltic states have the interest to have that. But what we see today regarding support in Ukraine by Marshall Plan and assistance from U.S. also is not so clear. We talk much about assistance and about its effectiveness in Ukraine. In recent times, after the cooperation with European institutions and World Finance Organizations was renewed, Ukraine had received about $6 billion. Having such a sum, it was possible to employ Nobel Prize laureates, and they would assist in providing reforms and conduct a Marshall Plan for Ukraine. But I think today there is no confidence of our colleagues and partners that they really want to have strong and economically independent Ukraine. Dear Ambassador, what do you think?
On the contrary, I think Europe and the Western world needs economically successful and powerful and independent Ukraine. We know that the new financial assistance and new financial instruments are coming to Ukraine quite slowly, because Ukraine now has approximately $8 billion of unused foreign assistance. Of the we made calculations, and there are about $8 billion of international financial instruments and international financial assistance which is available for Ukraine.
Why?
There are different reasons. There are reasons of institutional capacity. There are probably administrative reasons. There are also some conditions not fulfilled, because, of course, Ukraine has to meet certain criteria to use all this financial assistance.
Igor, what do you see your answer? I would say about some double standards toward Ukraine, analyzing the associations agreement, we could see insufficient quantity of quotas for Ukraine. We also provided market access for EU, but the Europe did not. One of the important issues blocks the macrofinancial assistance for Ukraine is an exporting of
woodlocks.
So we have a problem on one side, interest. Politically, Ukraine could not afford itself to get a finance assistance, but in the same time to destroy the business in the country and decrease the
competitiveness.
So today it looks like a huge problem. Europe in some ways restricts Ukraine's development, and it's not good for bilateral relations. So there is a need, maybe, to change strategy toward Ukraine. Another question is how Ukraine should spend money from international funds. If there will be clear goals and monitoring from EU structures, it will not be difficult to deal with financing, and it would work more effectively.
The idea behind the so-called Marshall Plan or new European plan for Ukraine was exactly to help Ukraine increase investment into, first of all, infrastructure and support for small and medium business, which could increase competitiveness of the business inside Ukraine and stimulate economic growth. Of course, Ukraine is a powerful country with a powerful certain sectors of economy like agriculture or steel production, and of course there is a competition in these goods. But we can see that as a result of the free trade agreement, deep and comprehensive free trade agreement between Ukraine and the European Union, the exports of Ukraine to the EU has grown almost 25% last year. So it means that this agreement is working. But we need further reforms in Ukraine to encourage, as I said, small and medium business and increase competitiveness inside Ukraine.
Igor, does the export grow by 25%? What do you think? Yes, it grows, but it could grow even more. For example, grain quotes or honey quotes, which we use during within 1 month. Regarding grain, we have to look for African and Asian markets. We are suffering a hybrid war with Russia, and we also have a trade war with Russia. And one of the most important points of the association agreement that we would like to have is a possibility to get a wider access to European markets. But unfortunately, the problem of quotas for Ukraine is still exists, and we feel that. You know, before the war started, Russia used to be our huge trade partner, so after losing Russian markets, we hoped we would have wider access to EU markets. So I think this is the right time to renew this policy, to change tariff restrictions we have with the EU. And generally, it's a time to change the whole EU strategy to Ukraine. I absolutely agree. We have to improve our judicial system and institutions. We have better protect the rights of investors. Otherwise, the investments would not come to Ukraine. Investors should feel safe here in Ukraine. So in this regard, we fully understand that Ukraine has to do a lot to improve the conditions for foreign business. This is like our homework. Those $6 billion you mentioned above were not transferred to the state budget. It was spent to finance different project institutions, experts, and other spending as well. But we could use this sum more effectively and would achieve much better results. By now, we don't have an effective tax, customs, judicial, and security policy. What we have is just plans and intentions and promises of our politicians who declare the conducting of needed reforms.
Yes, we fully understand the Ukrainian position. Indeed, many Ukrainian producers and exporters, they need bigger quotas for the export into the EU, and there are some transitional periods stated in the free trade agreement. But gradually, Ukraine and the EU will be moving towards the full liberalization of trade. And of course, Ukrainian companies have to adapt European standards in order to increase their export into the European Union. And another important element is that Ukraine has to negotiate bigger quotas or better conditions with the European Union. I can tell it from the Lithuanian experience. In the beginning, we thought that everything we agreed with the European Union cannot be changed. But later we understood that Every issue is a matter of negotiations. And Ukraine, I would encourage Ukraine to be proactive in negotiations with the European Union and trying to convince why Ukraine needs additional quotas or better conditions. And I am convinced that really many things can be achieved.
Lithuania actively help Ukraine with business ombudsman, with anti-corruption sphere. Why do you do that?
I think this is a common European interest to strengthen rule of law in Ukraine and also create better conditions for business, better market economic conditions. And Lithuania has its own experience. We can tell our Ukrainian friends not only our positive experience, but also our mistakes, what we have made in this process. So we are absolutely open. And since we have good experts in this field, so they are working now in Ukraine. For example, Algirdas Šemeta, who is a business ombudsman in Ukraine, he is a former Minister of Finance of Lithuania and former European Commissioner. And of course, speaking about the corruption, we all perfectly understand that corruption is present probably in every country. But the most important thing, how the society tolerates corruption. So the main idea is to change the perception of the corruption and trying to create the atmosphere of intolerance to the corruption.
Do you think this help is effective?
I think it is effective, and Ukraine is improving on the anti-corruption field, both institutionally and by perception. Of course, there is a long way. The anti-corruption court is being created now in Ukraine. It will take some time, but if we have anti-corruption court, so we will have the full system of independent anti-corruption institutions in place.
Ігор, what could you say? Of course, many thanks for the ambassador and his country for helping Ukraine to create a system of protecting the rights of business representatives in our country. But talking about anti-corruption anti-corruption infrastructure, it seems to me that here in Ukraine we have created a myth and trying to fight it. What is that myth? We think that anti-corruption bodies like National Anti-Corruption Bureau or Anti-Corruption Court would provide a victory over corruption. But the world experience showed that this was not enough for the full success. Ukrainian problem has its own roots. Our political and constitutional systems are the base of corruption. This is the place from which corruption comes. Corruption is a consequence of relations and interconnection in a power triangle. So the most important point is to fight not the consequence of this problem, but to define a problem and fight the problem itself. Now we have a poor situation, like the seat in a parliament costs money. If one wants to get into the Verkhovna Rada, he should pay. Then the coalition is formed and some representatives of parliament fraction are appointed in the cabinet of ministers and a big state-run companies. So they spend money to be elected, and after getting the power, they try to gain profits using their power.
Так і не пройшли ці зміни, хоча ми мали це зробити по договору про асоціацію. Дякую, Ігор, що доєднався до нашого інтерв'ю.
Дякую вам, дякую, пан Павло.
Дякую.
Tell us about defense cooperation between our countries.
I think our defense cooperation is one of the most active fields of the relations between Lithuania and Ukraine. And Lithuania, together with other NATO countries, are helping Ukraine to train the army to better understand NATO standards and to be better prepared for the aggression.
And weapons, I believe. You're delivering weapons for it.
Yes, indeed. We were one of the first countries to give Ukraine very symbolic, but very important psychologically, we think, the lethal aid.
how comfortable or difficult is for Lithuanian businessmen is to work in Ukraine? And what Ukraine should do, should change in order to make it more attractive for foreign investors?
I can say that Lithuanian business shows very high interest in the Ukrainian market, and we have a number of companies that already for a number of years are working in Ukraine. We have bigger investment, we have smaller investment, and we have an interest of new Lithuanian companies to come into Ukrainian market. But many investors are a bit cautious because we need a better rule of law in Ukraine. We need to see that the property rights are better protected. And I think this criteria is the most important for business Lithuania and other foreign business to come more actively into Ukraine.
We already have spoken about that, but I want to ask this question in more details. How can your help will make Ukraine a strong country?
Lithuania and its experts can help Ukraine because we have a close mentality, close legacy, close we have shared history, and we have our lessons learned, and very fresh lessons learned. It's only 25, 30 years that Lithuania was in the same conditions as Ukraine was in early 90s. So we can tell from our own experience how is the best way for Ukraine to move forward, and also to tell what mistakes we made and what are the ways to avoid those mistakes for Ukraine.
What can be done in order to end the war in Donbas?
In order to ask to answer this question, we have to remember who started this war. We know that it's Russia, and people inspired by Russia, people who were supplied by Russia.
And even Russian soldiers, to be honest.
Yes, and including Russian regular troops. And we perfectly understand that the end of the conflict in the eastern Ukraine depends very much on Russian efforts and Russian willingness to implement Minsk agreements and to find a diplomatic solution to the conflict.
But it doesn't look that they stop, because they just last Sunday organized a pseudo elections there.
We think that those so-called or we we may call it fake elections, they are not helping Minsk process. So they are harmful for the Minsk process, and they do not show willingness by Russia to really find a solution to this conflict.
Thank you, Mr. Janukonis, for joining our program. Thank you all who watched us. See you in a week.
Thank you very much for the conversation.